I think an interesting place to start is in 2014, Naval Ravikant wrote a blog post that he has since then taken down, where he argued that the internet is missing a fifth protocol. He argued at the time that that was probably going to be Bitcoin, which is maybe why he took it down. But what the point of the fifth protocol was that in the future, we're going to have a lot of AI, we're going to have a lot of robots, we're going to have a lot of self-driving cars, we're going to have a lot of machine intelligence out in the world that will need money to solve problems in the world. So they will need internet native money, and they will need things like smart contracts. In 2014, this was a pretty cool and wild vision. I was living in Beijing at the time, reading this post and being like, this is the strongest case I've heard for crypto so far. I see it. The crypto is not for me to use, it's for future AI to use. Computers need internet native money. Fast forward to where we are now. In 2019, I started building, we founded this company in 2019, doing something wildly different. We were doing augmented reality for the tabletop game Warhammer. That's where my profile picture came from. It was COVID, Games Workshop was doing very, very well. And frankly, I just wanted to sell them a business and go work there. I just thought Games Workshop seems like a really, really cool company. I'm gonna sell them something and go work there. So I spent all summer thinking about what can I do that I can sell to Games Workshop. And I had the idea of, why don't we add augmented reality overlays to the game, make it easier for the 2 million people at the time that were watching Warhammer games every month on YouTube, make it easier to understand, make it more accessible to people with less autism than myself that want to understand the game. But fortunately slash unfortunately, I got super hooked on an underlying technological problem that I didn't know the world had, and I think most people don't know that the world has, which is that the GPS is fundamentally unfit for the era of AI and robotics. Spatial computing is the art of teaching digital devices, machines, robots to understand the physical world. Famously, the roboticist Moravec, who's mentioned a lot at this conference this year, pointed out that it's easier to make an AI that is a chess champion than it is to make an AI that can fold a shirt or crack an egg. Why is that? It's because machine proprioception, like understanding where your body parts are, it's very, very difficult. Sense of touch, very difficult. Movement, very difficult. Navigation, very, very difficult. Spatial computing is the umbrella for all of the activities teaching machines to do things in the physical world. When Apple released the Apple Vision Pro, they didn't call it a VR headset or an AR headset. They called it a spatial computer. Very smart, because what they are trying to signal is not that this is a headset. That's missing the point. The point is, this is a computer that understands space. And a couple of companies you may have heard of, Apple, Tesla, Google, Microsoft, Nvidia, all of the top seven tech companies in the world are spending a very, very considerable chunk of their money building in spatial computing. Why? Because we've understood that the GPS is not gonna cut it. Someone needs to build a GPS replacement. Why is the GPS not gonna cut it? Well, it turns out satellite-based positioning is actually line-of-sight based. The reason GPS doesn't work in here is because we cannot see the sky. And in a place like Hong Kong, where I live, there are over 4,000 skyscrapers. You can compare that to New York, the biggest city in the West, only has 900. By the standard of this century, Asian cities are the benchmark for what a big city is. And in Asian cities, you don't see the sky. So GPS works very poorly in modern Asian cities. So working on this Warhammer app, I realized, fuck, I can't make shared augmented reality where all of us see the same thing at the same table because our devices don't have a shared understanding of the space. The smart thing to do at that point is to just pack up shop and say like, well, fuck this augmented reality idea. But instead, I spent the next 2 years trying to figure out, how do we crack this actually? I learned that all of the big tech companies have bet big on visual positioning. Visual positioning is the idea that you look at the world and you compare it to a model of the world to figure out where you are. So Google has a visual positioning system, Apple has a visual positioning system, Tesla has a visual positioning system, Microsoft has a visual positioning system. The problem with a visual positioning system, even though it's much, much more accurate than GPS, is one, of course, you need to have a model of the space, and no one has a model of your apartment, your business, the grocery store. There are lots of places that aren't modeled and that don't want to be modeled and kept in some centralized place of business. But also the problem is comparing what you see to the model, any kind of computational comparison, the compute and the data need to be in the same place. The compute and the data need to be in the same place. That means that you're either moving the model of the world onto the device, which is a very big download, or you're sending what the robot is seeing to the model and do the computation there. This is the far more feasible way to do things. So that is literally, quite literally, how AR glasses work today. When you see prototypes from people like Niantic, the people that made Pokemon Go, of their future AR glasses, the way that they function is that they literally look through your eyes to figure out where you are. I think this is the biggest threat to privacy and cognitive liberty that we have faced as a civilization. And as I started realizing this, I forgot about Warhammer and thought like, okay, replacing the GPS is maybe the most capital V venture scale thing that you can attempt to do. Because Naval was wrong. We're not just missing a fifth protocol. We're missing a sixth protocol. Naval used this example of cars wanting to coordinate and do lane merging. And we used to live in Beijing. So here's a stat you can sympathize with. On the roads of Beijing, there are more cars on the road than there are people in Los Angeles. Just again, the scale of Asian cities, right? There are more cars on the road than there are people in Los Angeles. And the average commute is 2 hours. Now you might, so what does that mean? Back with a napkin calculation, let's do it really quick. It means that every week, the time it took to build the pyramids is lost in Beijing traffic, right? Just Beijing traffic, one pyramid every week. It's a lot of human productivity lost. Now we might think like, oh, but self-driving cars is gonna fix this, right? In the future, self-driving cars are gonna be driving at 100 miles an hour all the time. They're gonna be coordinating with each other. We don't even need red lights. Sure, if and only if Naval is right and there's a fifth protocol so that all of these different brands and cars can permissionlessly negotiate things like lane merges with each other. How much of a hurry are you? How much of a hurry am I? Am I willing to pay 1 cent to cut across from you? But also, they can only do it if they can actually communicate, no, please, please, actually communicate their precise position and vector. And you can't do that with a GPS. If you're trying to coordinate these hunks of metal moving at 100 miles an hour and you don't have precise positioning and precise speed, you can't coordinate it. You would start struggling to coordinating traffic moving faster than like 10 miles per hour. So I realized, holy shit. Civilization is missing a GPS replacement that is made for the robotics and AI era. And we started building that in 2021. We invented something, patented something in early summer of 2021, which was the first way ever to get two devices, like two phones, to get into a shared coordinate system with sub-centimeter precision in under a second. This was in the metaverse craze. So it was a perfect time to show that, look, the future of the world is probably AR layers everywhere. No one can do shared augmented reality without a minute long calibration process today. We've brought it down to under a second. What do you think? Mm. And within a very short period of time, we had raised 19 million in change to start building what we now call a decentralized machine perception network, or a DPIN, to allow machines and AI to look at the world and exchange spatial data and spatial compute with each other. Why does it matter? Well, it matters because they have to be able to navigate the world. It matters because doing it decentralized means that you can let people retain the ownership of their world models, so that you can actually map the places that don't want to be mapped. For example, we found great product market fit for one of our applications in the retail industry. Let's say that it's the year 2030 and we're sitting here, we have our Optimus robot with us, and we want to send the Optimus robot across the street to go get us some ice cream. The Optimus robot will have to know how to navigate out of this conference hall, but there's no map of this conference hall today that the Optimus robot has access to. So, okay, he doesn't know his way out. That's a problem. Then he goes out at street level. On the street level, sure, maybe he can use GPS to get to roughly the right area, but he also needs to be able to understand not to walk in the middle of the road, use the sidewalks. No infrastructure for that today. And when he gets to the store, he needs to know where the fuck is the ice cream? And there is nothing like that today either. Does Google know where the ice cream is in the store? No, because how to place your products on the shelf in the store is actually a very protected secret. So protected that most retailers literally refuse to keep any data about it on a cloud provider. So Google is not ever, ever gonna have a map of what the inside of a grocery store looks like, which means that if we don't decentralize this process, it means that your humanoid robot will always have to go look for the ice cream in the grocery store like a fucking idiot, like us, right? What we want is a world where the robot can arrive at the store and ask, where's the ice cream? And the store knows how to answer, where's the ice cream? In a mutually intelligible spatial language. And that's what we've built. So if I start an elevator pitch right now, the elevator pitch is this. 70% of the world's economy, according to the World Bank, is still tied to physical locations and physical labor, meaning they are outside of the realm of AI because AI can only act on digital information. So to get AI to help us in the majority of the human economy, we have to teach AI to see the world. And the best way to see the world is not to be limited to your own sensors, but to be able to collaborate with other people and to reward them for collaborating with you and allow people to retain the ownership of their data. So instead of doing what Google or Elon is doing, building one big digital model of the world that everyone sends their camera feeds to, we're making a protocol to allow robots to move from private to private to private maps that are interoperable with each other. We think it's the missing sixth protocol of the internet. And it's going to do things like extend the range of robots, allow for smaller form factor of AR glasses. In fact, here's my most controversial belief. I think we will beat Meta and Apple to all-day wearable AR glasses. Because the collaborative spatial computing approach, where you can move the compute away from the device itself, allows for a radically smaller form factor. So one thing that we can do with this, for example, our most recently filed patent. Just so like, what can you do with AI once AI gets spatial, right? So let us assume we've taken the step of mapping the store. Let us assume we've taken the step of showing the store where all the products are. And now let's assume we have CCTV cameras. Right? You have a normal two-dimensional image feed. But using this technology, we also map what is the precise position of the camera. So now we know where is the camera in the space. Helpful. And we calculate what the camera intrinsics are of the camera, meaning what is the distortion of the lens, things like this. Now, computer vision always looks at a two-dimensional image, right? XY coordinates, pixels, that's computer vision. And if you do something like human pose estimation, for example, you may have seen it where it shows a little robotic skeleton of how you are placed, like in motion capture. Have you seen this? It's called human pose estimation. Yeah. Human pose estimation is scale invariant. What that means is the camera doesn't know how tall you are. They don't know if you're a very tall person standing far away or a tiny little person very close. Okay. There's not enough information for the camera to know that. Does that make sense?
Yes.
We solve those problems by having stereoscopic vision, right? We have two eyes. If you ever try walking around a completely new place with only one eye, it's actually very hard for us to figure out how big things are, especially things that are not connected to the ground. right? So
inflammation in my eye, I'll be bumping into stuff all the time.
Computer vision has no sense of 3D space. But what we figured out we can do, if we know where the camera is, if we know what the camera intrinsics are, if we know the shape of the store and where the products are, when we do human pose estimation, we can do what's called a ray cast, which is a mathematical operation where we imagine we shoot a laser beam to see what we would hit. And we shoot that laser beam at their feet. Why? Well, because the feet, we know at one part in every stride, the definition of walking is actually that both of your feet are at the ground at some point. Fun fact about walking. So by identifying where in your stride both of your feet are on the ground, we now know 2 points on the ground, because we're really ray casting against the ground where the feet are. Does that make sense? Yeah. And that's now a known distance, because we have a 3D model of the store and we know how big the store is. So now we actually know the distance between your feet, which means that now we actually know how tall you are, which means now we can actually place your head in 3D space, which means now we can actually project a cone for where you're looking. Meaning now we can actually see which products you've even looked at. So we make it possible for the first time ever for any kind of retail location to track which products got eye traffic. The only way to do that today is literally with eye tracking glasses, like the Swedish company Tobii. They will give eye tracking glasses to test customers to see where people look. But we could check for literally every customer that walks through the store. How many seconds were they exposed to the chocolate? And again, this is just a tiny, tiny, tiny use case that we think is going to be worth within 3 years, 0.36 billion in recurring revenue. Yeah.